From the best-selling Christian Heroes Then and Now series, YWAM Publishing presents William Booth, Soup, Soap, and Salvation by Janet and Geoff Benge. Read for you by Tim Gregory. For information about other titles in this outstanding series, please visit our website at ywampublishing.com or call us at 800-922-2143. Chapter 1. A Thorn in the Flesh. Elizabeth Geike, a pretty blue-eyed woman with a dark complexion from Dundee, Scotland, raced out of her tiny mud hut in the jungle near the village of Aladi in Nagercoil, India, to see where the blood-curdling noise was coming from. It was coming from the path that led to her dwelling. Soon a group of men from Aladi were approaching her hut. They carried a man who was the source of all the noise. At first Elizabeth thought he might be crazy, and the villagers were bringing him to torment her. She waited anxiously as the group stopped in front of her hut and laid the man at her feet.
"This man has something wrong, and we don't know what to do,"
one of the men in the group said. Elizabeth soon learned that the man was not mad at all, but was wailing from excruciating pain. But what was the source of the pain? Had he eaten poison or been bitten by a cobra? She knelt down and began to inspect his body for clues to the pain. It was then that she noticed his left foot was swollen. She touched it, and the man let out another blood-curdling yell. Gingerly, she inspected the foot, where she found the source of the pain, a small point protruding from the sole. It was the end of a huge, embedded thorn. From the hut, Elizabeth fetched her medical kit. But inside it she found only petroleum jelly, Epsom salts, and castor oil, and not the forceps she needed to extract the thorn from the man's foot. She would have to improvise. To the horror of those gathered around, Elizabeth knelt down, leaned forward, and placed her lips against the dirty, calloused sole of the man's foot. She then clamped her white teeth around the protruding end of the thorn and slowly moved her head back. Bit by bit, the embedded thorn began to slide out of the foot until her head jerked back and the thorn was out. Immediately, the man let out a cry of relief as his agonizing pain began to subside. With the thorn extracted, Elizabeth bathed the wound in coconut oil and then wrapped a lint bandage around it. Soon, the man and the group that had brought him disappeared as quickly as they had arrived. The next day, the group of men were back. This time, they did not have another injured person with them. Instead, they wanted answers.
"Why is it that you, a white woman, would want to save the life of a man by placing your lips, the most sacred part of the body, against his foot, the most despised part of the body? Because my God, who loves and values all men, asked me to do it," she replied. This was the opening Elizabeth Geike had been praying for,
and soon those in the group were clamoring to know more about her God. First, the man whose foot she had extracted the thorn and his wife became Christian converts. Soon others from the village followed, until the nucleus of a small church had been formed. William Booth laid the report from India that contained Elizabeth Geike's story on his desk and walked to his office window. As he looked out at the brick and stone facades of London's buildings, a smile of satisfaction settled across his face. Elizabeth's action was the kind of selfless demonstration of the power of the gospel that touched people and changed their hearts. Her action was more powerful than the words of any sermon. Despite the vicious persecution members of the Salvation Army had endured since setting foot in India, Elizabeth was a woman who would not allow the message of God's love to be silenced. Elizabeth had done what William and any other member of the Salvation Army would have done. they would have shown God's love in whatever practical way possible. In the very streets of London below, people were out doing the same thing at that moment, helping the poor and needy, comforting the sick and the weak, and bringing the hope of God's love into otherwise hopeless lives and situations. That is what William Booth had striven to do all his life. From the first time he encountered those on the fringes of society in his hometown of Nottingham, he had been drawn like a magnet to them and their needs. They were the people God had given him to minister the gospel to. And now, a vast army of people like Elizabeth Geikie were spread around the world doing the same. William sank back into the chair behind his desk to continue reading the dispatch from India. Before he could pick up the paper, he found his thoughts wandering back to Nottingham, where it had all begun. Chapter 2. Always Seek the Advantage. William Booth raced across the cobblestone street, leaping over a large muddy puddle. The bell was just being rung as he reached the bottom step to Biddulph's School for Young Gentlemen. Before he mounted the steps, William glanced down to make sure his jacket buttons were properly fastened and there was no mud on his shoes. As he did so, he spied a small leather pouch lying beneath the hedge. He walked over and picked it up. Inside were 3 coins, a shilling and 2 sixpences. William whistled to himself. It was a lot of money. He stuffed the pouch and the money into his trouser pocket. He would have to think carefully about how he might spend it. All the other 10-year-old boys in his class were standing in line when William finally made it up the stairs and into the hallway. He quickly joined the end of the line, trying to make himself as inconspicuous as possible. This was difficult, however, since he was tall for his age, a good head and shoulders above anyone else in the class. Soon the boys were all seated at their desks. As they recited Latin phrases, William's attention wandered, and he began to stare out the window. It was a gray, overcast day in 1839, and Nottingham looked as drab and uninviting as ever. In the grimy, dank street below, a young girl holding a crying baby wandered by, followed by a coal merchant on a cart pulled by a scraggly, emaciated horse. A ruler rapped on William's desk. "I doubt you have listened to a word I've said, Mr. Booth," the teacher exploded. "Students who do not listen in class fail in their homework. Tomorrow I shall be paying close attention to the work you do at home tonight." With that, the teacher dismissed the class for lunch. William stuffed his books in his bag and joined the other boys leaving the classroom.
"I think I'm in trouble now,"
he said, half smiling to his best friend, Robert Powell.
"You'll get through it. You always do,"
Robert replied, and then his face darkened.
"Besides, you don't really have a problem compared to Harry and me."
"What do you mean?"
William asked.
"My mother gave me money this morning to pay our school fees. I know I put it in my pocket, but when I got to school, the money was gone. I don't know what I'm going to do. My father will whip me when I tell him."
"My father would do the same to me,"
William agreed. Then a thought flashed through his mind. He reached into his pocket and felt the money pouch.
"Was the money in anything?" he asked. "A small leather pouch," Robert replied. "But there's no use looking for it. Even if I knew where I dropped it, someone would have found it by now."
William's hand closed around the pouch in his pocket, but something stopped him from pulling it out. He heard the echo of his father's voice.
"Always seek the advantage, lad. Always seek the advantage."
So what should William do in this situation? He knew he would give the money back to Robert. It belonged to Robert, and William could not keep it knowing that. But how should he give it back? Should he just say,
"Here, I found this,"
or think of some other way to return the money that gave him an advantage over Robert and his brother Harry. William released the pouch and pulled his empty hand out of his pocket. Patting Robert on the back, he said,
"Don't worry. There'll be some way out of this. I'll help you."
By the time lunch was nearly over, William knew what he would do. He put his soup spoon down and turned to his friend.
"Robert, I've been thinking about how bad it would be to go home and tell your mother you lost the money. It just so happens that I have 2 shillings in my bag. I've been saving it up for a year. I was going to use it to buy myself a model train, but I don't see how I can do that now, since my best friend is in need."
He reached into his pocket and emptied the coins out of the pouch. He then pulled the coins from his pocket.
"Here, you take them," he said.
"But I couldn't,"
Robert said, his eyes wide with surprise.
"Really, I couldn't. It's such a lot of money. I never knew you had so much saved."
"You must take it,"
William said, putting the coins on the table between them.
"If you don't, you and Harry will both get a thrashing."
"I'll think of a way to pay you back. Honest, I will,"
Robert said, as he scooped up the money. William finished his soup with a sense of quiet satisfaction. His father would be proud of him. He had found a way to give the money back while getting the advantage. Before they went home from school that night, Robert thrust something into William's hand.
"Here," he said, "take this. My uncle brought it back from India for us. But I want you to have it, to say thank you."
William looked down. There in his hand was Robert Powell's pride and joy, a shiny sterling silver pencil case. He hesitated for a moment. Should he tell Robert the whole truth? No, it was too late now. Besides, he had always admired the pencil case.
"Thank you,"
William mumbled without looking up.
"I have to go now."
As William walked over the bridge on his way home that evening, he threw the empty money pouch into the River Trent. On the other side of the river, he noticed that a makeshift scaffold had been set up, and a huge crowd had gathered around it. He stopped at the edge of the crowd to see what was happening.
"He deserves everything he gets,"
an old woman said to a man in a baker's hat and apron.
"That he does," the baker replied. "Imagine he killed his wife and children. Whatever he gets is too good for him."
As William climbed halfway up a gaslight pole for a better look, a man was marched out onto the scaffold. A cheer went up from the crowd, and mothers held up their young children for a better look. A bag was placed over the man's head, and then the man was dragged over to the hanging noose. As the crowd went wild with excitement, William felt his stomach turn. He did not want to be there. He did not want to see a man die with the echo of a cheering crowd in his ears. Quickly, William climbed down the gaslight pole and slipped into a side street. Tears streamed down his face as he raced to get as far away from the crowd as he could. He was glad to get home to his mother.
"What's the matter?"
Mary Booth asked as he came in the door.
"You look as white as a sheet."
William sat down at the kitchen table and began telling his mother what he had seen.
"Hush," she said. "Don't say another word in front of the little ones."
She then turned and addressed William's 2 younger sisters.
"Emma, Mary, you 2 go upstairs and put away your dolls."
When they had gone, William continued recounting his story. He was nearly finished when his older sister, 12-year-old Anne, burst into the room.
"Mother," she said, "have you heard the awful news? There was a riot at the hanging today. The crowd kept pushing closer and closer to the scaffolding until it gave way. 12 people were crushed to death. 12 people. They say one of them was Mr. Jameson, our bootmaker."
Mary Booth got up and put her arms around her daughter.
"God help us," she said. "The world is becoming a more brutal place every day. Imagine,
12 people losing their lives, trying to get a better view of such an awful sight.
Following that event-filled day, things returned to the mundane for William Booth. During the week, he attended school, and on the weekends, he helped his father, Samuel, with his house-building job. The following year, Mr. Biddulph, William's schoolmaster, invited the students to attend a meeting at the Broad Street Chapel in Nottingham. This was a Methodist church started 3 years before, in 1837. Everyone talked about how huge the building was inside. It had enough seats for 2,000 people. William's father told him it had cost the enormous sum of £11,000 to buy the land and build the church. As William stood outside, staring up at the four columns that formed the colonnade at the front of the church, he wondered what the service inside would be like. Until now, William had attended St. Stephen's Anglican Church with his mother and three sisters. His father seldom attended the church, and William understood why. The minister stood in a pulpit high above the congregation and preached using such big words that William could understand little of what was said, and his voice droned on so that William had to fight to stay awake. The service at Broad Street Chapel was astoundingly different from anything else William had experienced. The preacher read from the Bible and then, using simple words and ideas, carefully explained the meaning of the passage. As he spoke, people in the congregation yelled out, "Praise the Lord" and "Hallelujah." William could hardly believe it. A person would be removed from St. Stephen's for yelling at the preacher. And the singing amazed him too. He had never heard such hymns before, so full of joy and action. They made him want to get up and march around the room. And the way the prayers were said was also totally foreign to William. Instead of reading from page 62 of the prayer book, people just spoke out their own prayers, made up right there on the spot. By the time the service was over, William knew one thing for sure. This was the liveliest church he had ever experienced, and he was going to come back as often as he could for services. The summer of 1842 was one William would never forget. It was the summer in which his father lost all of the family's money. The man who had always encouraged William to seek the advantage made one shaky deal too many, and the family was ruined financially. There was no way William could continue attending school. It was much too expensive. Besides, he was now 13 years old. Old enough to get a job and contribute to the family income. Within days, William's clothes were packed, and he was sent off to work for Francis Eames. Mr. Eames was a pawnbroker in Goosegate, Nottingham, and William was to be his apprentice for 5 years. This meant that William would live above the pawn shop and learn the trade of pawnbrokering. The sudden change in his circumstances shocked William, but he realized there was little he could do about it. His father was in charge of him, and he had no choice but to obey him. William began to learn the ways of the pawnbroker. The idea was simple, really. Customers brought in items, and Mr. Eames assessed the value of the items and paid the customer about 60% of what they were worth. Then he held the items for 2 weeks. If the customer did not come to buy the items back, he sold them at a profit. Of course, most of the customers were hopeful, even confident that in 2 weeks' time, they would have the money to redeem their belongings. But few of them did. William's first job was to sweep the floor and fold the clothes and bedding that people pawned. This was not hard to master, though he had to constantly be on the lookout for ticks and lice that crawled out of the blankets. Soon Mr. Eames promised William that he would show him how to decide what an item was worth and how to extract the most money from the transaction.
"This is just the job my father would enjoy.
taking advantage of people in their weakest moments,
William thought to himself as he folded and swept. But William could not enjoy the game. He was too concerned about the customers and what they would do next. Some men became wretched enough to pawn the tools of their trade, the carpenter's level and saw, a bricklayer's trowel, or a butcher's knives. William wondered how they would ever get on their feet again without a way to make a living. Just about all the customers who sought out the pawn shop, with its three brass balls hanging over the doorway, lived in quiet desperation. Often the same customers came back time after time to pawn more of their or their family's possessions for cash to put food on the table or pay the rent on the pitiful hovels they lived in. Over time, William began to see that there was a pattern to the way people pawn things. The first time he met new customers, they brought in such items as umbrellas, articles of clothing, and furniture. But as time went by, these same people began bringing in more and more necessary items, such as plates, teapots, and tools, until finally, they came wanting to pawn their wedding rings. Although William felt sorry about the plight of these people, things were also going from bad to worse for the Booth family. In September, William's father died. At 68 years of age, he was an old man by the standards of the day, and his marriage to William's mother, Mary, was his second marriage. His first wife and child had died long ago. William hardly knew how to feel about his father's death. Samuel Booth had always been a distant man, pushing William to make deals and get ahead in the world. Two things William felt uneasy about. It was his mother to whom he was most attached. She was the one who encouraged him and told him that one day things would get better. With her husband's death, William's mother set up a tiny shop not far from the pawnbroker's in Goosegate. William's three sisters became the shop assistants. The shop sold sewing needles, thread, hatpins, handkerchiefs, and other small items that women needed. Whenever she could, Mary Booth slipped into Eames Pawnbroker's to find out how William was faring. On Sundays, William sometimes went to St. Stephen's Church with his mother and sisters. But more often than not, he walked the extra distance to Broad Street Chapel. He had grown to love this church, especially the chance to listen to the outstanding preachers who spoke there. Two of them, the Reverend James Cowie from the United States, and Yorkshireman Isaac Marsden, particularly inspired him. Something about their preaching drew him like a magnet. Sometimes, after hearing a stirring sermon, William would wander off to Wilford Meadows and try preaching to himself. He was always disappointed with the results, though. The famous preachers he heard at Broad Street Chapel were powerful and articulate. There was something else about them. They spoke with fiery conviction. It was obvious they believed what they were preaching with all their heart. William, on the other hand, was not sure what he believed. Even though he had been going to this church for 2 years, William was still a spectator. He enjoyed the free-flowing atmosphere there, the lively singing and the preaching, but he had never settled the matter about the state of his own soul. It seemed an enormous decision to give his life wholly to God in the way that the Methodist preachers encouraged their listeners to do. That was the case until one night late in 1844, when 15-year-old William Booth strolled into Bible class. The teacher, Henry Carey, opened with the words, "A soul dies every minute." For some reason, these words penetrated right into William's heart. What if he died? Where would his soul go? Did he truly belong to Jesus Christ, or was he going to spend the rest of his life dabbling around the edges of Christianity? As William pondered these questions, a thought rushed through his mind.
God shall have all there is of William Booth.
Henry Carey continued speaking to the Bible class, but William was scarcely aware of what his teacher was saying. The thought played over and over in his mind. Finally, as the class drew to a close, Henry Carey announced, "If anyone would like to own his sins and surrender his life to God, he may meet me at the back of the room." Without hesitation, William leaped from his seat and hurried to the back. He knelt at a wooden table and poured out his thoughts to God. Almost immediately, Robert Powell's silver pencil case came to mind. William had felt guilty about having it from the day he tricked Robert with the lost money. Now he knew he had to do something about it. He prayed, "God, I promise I will return the pencil case to Robert as soon as I can." Then he stopped and thought for a moment, and then went on, "And I will even tell him how I tricked him into giving it to me." As William spoke these words, he felt a huge weight lift from his mind. He no longer had to seek the advantage in every deal. There was something much more important to seek now: God's will. William felt lighter than air that night as he walked back to Eames' pawn shop. He might be a lowly apprentice, but he was determined to give his life, every bit of it, to God. Of course, he didn't have the least idea what God would do with his life. Chapter 3. William's People. That light-hearted feeling did not desert William in the days following his experience at Broad Street Chapel. In fact, he felt even lighter after he found Robert Powell, apologized for tricking him with the money, and gave his silver pencil case back. William also found he was more patient with the customers at the pawn shop and was always ready to quote a few words from the Bible to comfort them. Sometimes he even invited them to attend church, though most people just shook their head or laughed in his face. William longed to do something more effective to share the gospel with these people. But if they refused to come to church with him, what else was there? 2 years passed before an opportunity to branch out in evangelizing presented itself. One winter's day in 1846, 17-year-old William Booth lay ill in bed. His fever had gone down some, and the doctor told him he would get better as long as he rested. Resting was not an easy assignment for such an active young man. But as he lay there, William thought a lot about his commitment to give his whole life to God. But what could a 17-year-old apprentice do that would make any kind of difference in the world? He did not have the freedom to train to become a pastor, and besides, he did not like reading and studying much. Nor did he have the money to help the poor people who came through the doors of the pawn shop every day. Just as William was beginning to despair that his Christian commitment would never amount to much, there came a knock at the door. His friend Bill Sansom opened it and strolled in.
"I hear you've been through a rough patch,"
Bill said in his usual cheerful manner.
"I brought a pudding my mother baked for you. But if you're not well enough to eat it, I'll take it back. My mother's the best cook in town, you know."
William grinned. Bill had a way of making a person see the brighter side of things.
"Leave it here,"
William replied, grinning.
"I'm on the mend. The doctor says the worst is over. All I have to do is to get strong again. And I think a good pudding will help."
"I know something else that would help," Bill said.
"Some of us boys from the Bible class have decided to form a club and start preaching in the poorest parts of the city. Why don't you join us? It would give you a reason to get back on your feet, and I know you'd be good at it. After all, half the people we are going to preach to probably visit your pawn shop at least once a week. How about it? What do you say?"
"Well, yes, all right," William replied, astonished that an opportunity to make a difference had just presented itself.
"As soon as I'm well enough, I'll join you. I take it you preach on Sunday afternoons."
"And in the evenings.
I'll tell the other lads to be expecting you. If not next week, then the week after. Better go now. I have to deliver a spool of Belgian lace to one of my father's customers.
After Bill had left, William lay back in his bed and thought. He knew it was a sin to envy anyone. But it was hard not to envy Bill. He came from a well-to-do family. His father was an importer of fashionable Belgian lace.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.